5 hard lessons learned importing from China. How did it affect me and how can you benefit from them? Let's take a look. What's up guys, Chris Craze here and we're gonna talk about 5 hard lessons learned importing from China. How did it affect me and how they're gonna benefit you? Well, you may ask, what are these lessons? Well, first and foremost, let's go into detail here and say, these aren't lessons that are learned within a week or 2 weeks of importing. This is over 10 years span and interviewing a bunch of friends and other colleagues that have imported for many, many years from China. What are some of the things that they do and why do they do it? Well, we may not know the why, but we can definitely give you tips on how to correct them and make sure they're better for your business so that you don't fall trapped to these when you're importing. So number one is samples. When you get samples, China will always send you samples if you ask. Now, as with anybody, they would normally send you the best sample first. Why would they do this? Because they wanna make sure that when they send you a sample, that you're gonna like it and that you're going to order more. So that's stupid if a business were to send you some crappy sample or some sample that was broke or something like that, because why would you order any more? Get it? So they're gonna send you the best of the best. They're gonna handpick whatever the best samples are, send you the best samples. Of course you're gonna like them. You're gonna put in an order. You're gonna order some more. And then what happens? You get the order, the big order comes in or it goes to Amazon or it goes to one of your suppliers or your fulfillments or whatever you do with the order. And then you find out that there's broken pieces, they don't look right, they look different than the samples or something is different. The problem here is different. A sample showed what was good and one way, and I have a pause here for a reason because there's a point with this, but the rest of the order is different. That's a problem. It's called a bait and switch or a smoke and mirrors, whatever you wanna call it, but it's wrong and it should not be done. And the suppliers, the manufacturers in China need to be aware of this. More importantly, what do you do to make sure that this doesn't happen to you? Well, you let them know in advance that you don't want this and you can politely do that by just telling them, hey, I've had a run-in with suppliers in the past and they've sent me samples that were better than the actual products that were sent. I just wanna make sure that the actual products sent are going to be the same as the samples. The way they function, the way they look, the color, everything. If anything can go wrong, think about it, make a list about what could go wrong, and then go in and tell the supplier that you want it to be exactly the same. Okay, there's gonna be some variances and minor details that are changed and it varies on product and we don't have to go into that great a detail here. But in general, if you order red products and they send you green products or a pink product or a faded red, that's a problem. If you order something, and this is very, very generic, that has 4 wheels on it and the wheels are a certain texture and color, but then the wheels turn around and they're a different texture and color that the pictures show different and the samples are different, that's a problem. If you think it's gonna be a problem, think about it like this. If you were to order it from one of your vendors online, or if you were just to be a person on Amazon and you see a picture and you order a product, if that product showed up to you and it was different than what you ordered online, would you be happy and satisfied? If the answer's no, then the product needs to be the same. I hope I get to you here because this is very crucial. If you don't do this, you could have a backlash of problematic products and customers because customers are gonna be mad that they don't have the product that they originally wanted and that's not good. What's number two? China will sell to anybody. Don't get me wrong on this. Yes, even an Apple iPhone or high-end stereo equipment that you cannot find anywhere else, you can find it in China, whether it's on the black market, whether it's through other suppliers. The actual factory itself may not supply it directly to somebody else because they want to admire and they want to adhere to whatever agreements that you have, which by the way, some of those don't stand because it's international. So we don't have to go into that in this video. That'll be another video, maybe a link down below. Anyways, China will sell to anybody. What does this mean? You can have China create a product for you. And I say China because China, I'm summing up here. I've dealt with them so long. I'm summing up all the factories, how their processes are, suppliers, manufacturers, yada, yada, yada. Anyways, you can have China build you a product, make you a product, whatever the case is. And if you don't patent it in the United States, what China's gonna do is they're gonna go ahead and they're gonna sell it to anybody they want. They don't care who it is because to them, a dollar is a dollar, as with any business. A dollar's a dollar. So if I sell to you, if I sell to you, if I sell to anybody else, it's all the same. It's money to me. And I don't care. That's their mentality. I don't care who it is. All your drama over here in the United States with patents and all that stuff, that's not their business. And they really don't care about it. So what they're going to do is they're going to sell it to anybody. Case in point, everybody knows the pop sockets that went on the back of the phones. Well, the guy that had pop sockets that technically created them, he basically sourced them in China, found a supplier, made a viral video. They went live. He did have a patent on it. He had trademark on the name, patent on the product. And what happened is myself and a bunch of other people on Amazon, we ended up getting a hold of these pop sockets and we started selling them on Amazon and they did very well. Well, then of course the patent comes around and their patent attorney starts shutting everybody down on Amazon, shutting the listings down. And yes, we could not sell those and it sucked because they were doing really well. But the supplier, which I was in contact with, basically was mad at this person because he was having other people shut down on the platform from selling the products. Well, the supplier had an agreement to supply this main guy, the pop socket guy, with these pop sockets to sell pop sockets. So what does he care? They're gonna be sold anyways. This was a prime example of him not caring, simply not caring, because he would sell to me, he would sell to him, he would sell to anybody else, knowing that there's a patent in the United States. And this guy in China, this factory, was getting mad because all these other people were getting shut down and not able to sell more pop sockets. Well, what happened, he was selling less because he had to channel all of them through this one guy. That pissed him off, and that was the moral of the story. So how do you avoid this? You can get patents that you're good. They're good. Get those. So don't ever try to not get a patent. But there's a disclosure with that, and we'll do another video on that. But patents, you do have to disclose everything about the product, how it functions, how it operates, what it looks like. So if you don't want to give your secrets away, maybe withholding a patent or doing a provisional patent may be the way to go. But that's another video. So getting a patent, more importantly, telling China not to sell to anybody else, but you really can't control that. So what's number three? Number three is China will change their build or their design or whatever the case is, a product inside a product on you at any given time. I've talked to a couple friends, they have businesses that import millions of dollars and they run certain industries with lights or DJ equipment or whatever the case is. And yes, the common problem here is you'll have a product, you'll be importing for a while, you'll have a manual written on the product, how it operates, how it functions, so on and so forth. And then just out of the blue, it's like someday, somewhere, somehow, some guy's like, oh, well, we're just gonna change this product in it, or we're gonna change this microchip, or we're gonna change the way this functions, or the color of this LED, or whatever the case is, and they change it. Well, the problem is they don't understand the repercussions down the road. They're changing it because they want to save a buck or they want to save some money. Yes, that's great and all, but the ripple effect happens. When you get down the line, well, the importer that has a brand, that has a company in the United States here, now they're getting an ish because they have to rewrite their manual or they have to send these products back and they have to get changed or retested or whatever the case is. It just becomes a nightmare. Or they send the product out to their customers without testing them, which I hope to God you don't do, and the customers get it, and the product doesn't function like the manual says, or like a previous version of that product does. So you could see where this just becomes a nightmare. What does that do? That creates problems for the brand in the United States here. So how do you avoid this? So it's called QC, QC, quality control. You get it? QC, QSC, QSC is a brand, not QC. QC, there's a company in China that will do this. There's many companies, or there's American companies that have stations in China and they'll QC, they'll quality control or quality check your products before they leave China. And what does that do? That actually helps with number one and number three on this list, because when you send the samples, they'll further check other products when they leave. When you're also making a product or you want to continuously ship, they check everything over there. So therefore, if there's a problem with the product or if there's a discrepancy or a difference, they stop it before it even ships to the United States. And sometimes these companies will actually go to the factories and they'll check in the factories before they even leave the factory so that you can say, yes, I want these and I accept these, or no, you need to take them back and you need to change them. They're different. And that actually helps. It does cost more money up front, but let me tell you what, it saves you a ton in the end, because the last thing you'd want is a bunch of products, regardless of how much you're shipping, to come on a boat or overseas or on a plane or regardless. I mean, you could have anything from 10 products to 100 products to, you know, multiple hundreds of thousands of products. The more products, the more money you're losing. Any money lost cuts into your margin. And most of the time on Amazon, the margins are already small because of the fact that there's so much competition. So the last thing that you'd want is to have to send your entire box of products back over to China to get retested or to get changed or whatever the case is, or have to change your listing. It's ridiculous. Leverage here. This is leverage. They want your money. You want their product. So here's the deal. If we're going to make this deal and exchange this, my guys come into your factory and check this, or your products get checked before they leave the country. That's a great way to leverage this. So use that as a tip. Think about that. What's number four? The supplier will give you a shipping time, but it's actually not the legit shipping time. The reason being is number of things. The supplier may say, hey, when you order the products, we're gonna take 5 days to ship it out until it actually starts shipping. Normally air freight, sea freight could be different as well, but sea freight normally always goes through a forwarder. Air freight can either go through a forwarder or it can go direct. I always like direct, and I've actually got it so good on some of my suppliers where if I send money before 12 o'clock PM PST from my account, it gets to China same day. They ship the same day if they stock the products. Remember, I've built relationships with the people over 10 years, so we do work together, and I have tips on other videos, but I'll actually get those products shipped out our Monday night, our time, and I'll receive them Thursday afternoon, on a rare occasion Wednesday. People tell me it's crazy, but yes, it can be done. It's not likely, so don't ever think about that, because that's not normally the norm. But if you have really good relationships built with these suppliers and you do well and you know exactly how to navigate, it can be done. But the case in point here is the suppliers will always tell you 5 days or 6 days or 4 days. Well, the problem here is this. You need to ask the supplier, are you going direct or are you going to a forwarder? Direct means supplier has DHL, FedEx, or UPS pick up from their facility and ship out. A forwarder always means that a courier will pick it up, or they'll ship it to the forwarder with local post, and that local post and the forwarder waits to get other products coming in from other people and consolidates and puts it in and does what he needs to do, and then boom, he ships it out as a whole. That whole process can turn around and take like 4 to 5 extra days. So if you ask, how do I get shipping time within 3 to 5 days? It's not a forwarder, it's direct. Do I pay a little bit more? Yes, I do, but I have the margins on my product to be able to do that. And in some cases, I'm almost using this to my advantage, because now my customers don't have to wait a longer time. So this might be good to note, but that's the case in point for number four, is the supplier is going to tell you a shipping time. You've got to clarify with the supplier. Is this going direct or is this going with a forwarder? If it's going with a forwarder, ask specific details. How far is the forwarder? How long is it going to take? What's the track record? But then again, you have to remember this. At the end of the day, they're going to tell you whatever the hell they want to tell you to just get you to send them the money and to get going, especially if it's a first-time transaction. Sometimes it's even worse down the road when you have an established relationship, because they know that you're not going to go anywhere, or they think that. So it's hard to navigate sometimes, but to no avail, just remember, you'll be able to do this, and these tips should help you. So what's number five on our 5 hard lessons learned importing from China and tips on how to fix them? Number five is metric versus US. This is almost a rookie mistake, but I still get caught up in it sometimes myself. When I'm doing measurements, when I'm doing weights and dims, weights and dimensions, for those of you that don't know the lingo, now you do. So weights and dims, metrics, all of that. So centimeters, millimeters, you want to make sure that you don't assume this, because if you do these wrong, things are going to be bad and you're going to be in a conundrum of ish. So make sure that you don't make that rookie mistake and make sure metric is metric and US is US. They're not using US unless they tell you. They're gonna be using metric because that's standard for them, which is normally centimeters or normally millimeters, depending on how big the items are that you're measuring and what the weights are, kilograms versus pounds, things like that. So as another bonus tip here, obviously air freight normally comes directly in. You don't have to worry about customs with FedEx and UPS. Don't quote me on this. It's not everybody, but generally this is the case. Now, you will get some duties with DHL. And of course, anything that comes in with sea shipment and overseas, you are gonna get hit with customs and broker fees and importing fees and all that. And I'll do a whole other video for you guys on that. If it's around here somewhere, the link, subscribe, ask, put it in the comments. But you know, get the information from me and I'm here to give it to you. Anyways, let's run those five tips again and we'll get out of here because it's been a while. So, five hard lessons learned importing from China and tips on how to fix them. Number one, samples. Make sure the samples and the continued products match. Number two, China will sell to anybody. So try to avoid this. Just make sure that you have a patent if you're in the US. Number three, China may change things on you. They may change periodically. You gotta make sure that you have some QC and quality control. Number four is the supplier will give you a shipping time. Clarify what that shipping time is. And number five, metric versus US. I'm Chris Craze, and until next time, I'm out.